All right, it's time to switch it up. We're going to incorporate some color into our scenes with this beautiful mountain meadow painting. Hello, my friend, and welcome to day 4 of my 10-day Painting the Wilderness Challenge. As a reminder, during this challenge, I'm giving away a copy of my book every day. And if you want a chance to win that, make sure to watch to the end of this video. So first things first, I am going to prep my watercolor journal using washi tape and leaving extra long ends so I can wrap them around the journal and kind of keep my paper together to keep that top layer really taut. Another benefit of using washi tape in this way, you don't have to use a journal, by the way, you can just kind of tape a piece of paper to your desk. Another benefit is that it creates a nice frame of white space and a very satisfying tape peel. So I also added some binder clips on either side to keep my paper even more taut and make painting, especially big washes like I'm doing, a little bit easier. I'm going to start this mountain meadow scene with the sky, basically how I start every scene. And I'm using the wet on wet technique. So I put clean water on my watercolor notebook all the way down. And then I'm using some Prussian blue, just a little bit, kind of watery Prussian blue, just one stroke right at the top. And I'm using water, clean water, after that first stroke to blend the Prussian blue down. I don't want it to be very, very vibrant, just kind of a light sky, a light blue sky. And that's because I am going to create a very, very subtle line of orange. I was going for kind of like a corally pink color. I started by mixing Quin Rose with Lemon Yellow Deep a little bit, but it wasn't quite as vibrant as I wanted. So now I'm gonna add some Opera Pink to that. And that kind of made it a little bit better. I really just want this to kind of be a subtle glow coming up from the middle of the scene. But honestly, let this be a lesson to you that not everything turns out the way that you hope, not everything turns out the way you expect, and that's okay. I'm just kind of leaning into it. So for the record, I did not let this dry first. My blue is still wet. And so once I added that kind of Opera Pink, Lemon Yellow Deep, Quin Rose mixture, I used just clean water to kind of blend it into the blue sky a little bit. Now it's all the way dry, as you can see, and it dried very, very subtle colors, which is exactly what I wanted. So I'm going to re-wet just the bottom half of my paper because I'm painting a background layer of mountain and I want there to be a mist underneath the mountain. In order for there to be mist with watercolor, usually you have to use the wet on wet technique to allow the white of the paper to shine through, something that we practiced in day 3 of this challenge for the misty forest. And so I am going to paint a dry mountain. As you can, I'm just kind of using Payne's Gray, a pretty light-ish value Payne's Gray, and doing a crooked mountain all the way across my paper into the wet bottom half of my paper that I created. So that was my intention behind getting the bottom half of my paper all the way wet and then leaving the top half dry. So the top of the mountain can have crisp edges while the bottom half of the mountain has that mist. So now I'm going to focus on, while this bottom half of my paper is still wet, I'm going to do the first layer, my first go round of the meadow. So I used Hooker's Green with just a little bit of Payne's Gray and did some loose strokes all the way across, leaving behind intentionally some white space. It doesn't really matter what those strokes look like at this point, it's just the bottom layer. I'm also going to take some white gouache to kind of accentuate the mist happening. You don't need white gouache. This is not a necessary step, but especially because the yellow of the sky was kind of shining through underneath, I didn't really want it to be so yellow underneath that mountain. So that's why I used some white gouache underneath to kind of accentuate the mist, and make that mountain a little more of a white mist as opposed to a yellow mist. The reason I have the yellow pink underneath is because I want that subtle glow above the mountain, not below it. So I added the gouache and it made my mountains tiny bit too white. So I did a dance of where I would add a little bit more blue and then I would add a little bit more white. And at some point it felt like it looked pretty decent. So I let that dry all the way. Now I am re-wetting my paper. I'm only re-wetting up to the mountain. So that's kind of an important part, mostly because if I were to go above the mountain, some of the water might reactivate some of the paint and it might make the mountain look not quite as crisp anymore. And so I want to only re-wet with clean water up to that line of the mountain so I can keep the ridge line pretty crisp. And now I'm painting with a darker green to add more layers onto the grass. This is similar to the night sky project day one of this challenge that we did, where we started with that lighter green, right? That lighter value green, let it dry, and now we're adding on darker green. In order to get a dark green, you just have to add Payne's gray or a dark blue to your Hooker's green, and it turns it into that really cool, like dark forest green. So I'm trying to intentionally leave behind pockets of that lighter green space and definitely leave behind pockets of that white space that I had already left behind with the first layer. And so when I've put down this green, now I'm going back. I washed off my paintbrush and I only have clean water. I'm going back with actually kind of a damp brush where I got clean water and then I blotted it on my towel so that my brush was pretty damp so that I can blend some of this color into the paper a little bit more and push it away from the white space. And once I've done that, I'm getting an even darker green, meaning adding more pigmented Payne's gray to the green so that I can add just a few more really dark spaces in this green field. I want this field to be, as you can see, pretty dark. And the way to get that like really cool contrast between the light and the mist in the meadow and the dark of the green is to make sure, once again, we leave behind the white space, because the magic, that kind of breathtaking, oh wow, that looks so beautiful effect, that comes from the contrast between the light and the dark spaces. And so it's really helpful to use a thirsty brush, which is just a clean, damp brush, something that we talked about in day two of this challenge. It's really helpful to use a thirsty brush to lift the paint, kind of blend it together while maintaining the white spaces. And here I'm adding, you know, just a few more strokes of that dark paint. And we're practicing the painting from light to dark, starting with light colors and then gradually getting darker, gradually building more dark colors into the scene, because that's how it's best to get that contrast without overpowering the light spaces. Because once you make something really dark in watercolor, it is very difficult to turn it back light. So to recap, the reason that we want some of these light spaces, that we want this kind of luminous texture in the grassy field, is because we want it to look like A, maybe some light is reflecting off of this field, B, maybe some mist is kind of permeating through this field, and C, because it looks really cool. So after I completed the dark, kind of made that luminous field with the greens, I did another layer of white gouache for mist below the mountain, just for added depth and to, again, accentuate the mist that is kind of hovering along the bottom of that mountain. And I'm showing you a little bit more how I started with the gouache and then I added a little bit more blue and just kind of went back and forth between the two paints, always using a clean brush to blend them together. So now is a really fun part. We're going to add the flowers to this field. And first, for the flowers, I'm just going to splatter on some white gouache. I don't want the white gouache to get the mountain, so that's why I'm taking a scratch paper and I put the scratch paper above the mountain so that my splatters don't hit to the mountain. And I'm just taking some white gouache and splattering it all over. I want some of the splatters to be big, some of the splatters to be small. The point is to make it look random and kind of wild, because this is supposed to be a meadow of wildflowers, right? So once I have splashed a bunch of that white gouache, now I'm going to take my paintbrush and intentionally paint some white flowers. And the flowers don't have to be any particular kind of flower. I'm really just painting like blobs of white in kind of a circle, but not really, maybe more like a crooked kind of oval. And then some of the flowers, I'm leaving a tiny little bit of space in the middle. That's so that I can put a little black dot in there, just as an added detail for the flower when we're all done. Another note about these flowers is I am intentionally painting them in clusters. That's one of my biggest tricks for any time you're painting something in nature. That's a lot of somethings, is to paint them in clusters, because then it's a little bit easier to make them look more random. So once I've painted the white flowers, I'm going back and I'm adding in carmine flowers, which are red flowers, because I wanted to add like a contrasting color. Something to note about red and green is they are complementary colors. And so when you mix red and green together, they will create brown. But when you use a complementary color as an accent, like when you use red flowers as an accent against a green grass, it just kind of creates a more of a pleasing contrast that adds maybe a little extra oomph, I guess, to this scene. With just the white flowers, I think it was very pretty, very serene. And the red flowers just add a little bit of extra playfulness to the scene. So I added those red flowers along with the white flowers. I also splattered on some red, and then I added just tiny little dots, especially in the big flowers, for the center of the flowers, for the center of some of them. And I used Payne's gray for that. I'm not using black basically in any of these scenes. That's because Payne's gray, when you get it to be very, very dark, it looks just like black, and it looks a little bit more, makes it more cohesive, as opposed to black sometimes can wash things out. So the final step in this piece is to add stems and grass to this scene, just as more texture. You don't have to add grass to every single part of the scene. We're not trying to make it look super realistic. We just want to add some pieces of grass around the flowers, some going up from the bottom, some starting in the middle and going up toward the middle. We just wanted to add some texture around the flowers so that it looks even more like this scene of wildflowers. And there's really not much to that, except one rule I might think about is subjects that are closer should be bigger, subjects that are farther away should be smaller. So maybe the grass in the back, probably those stems should be a little bit smaller than the ones in the front. Now I added some birds. After I painted this, I wasn't really sure that I liked the birds. I think I wanted to add some kind of, I don't know, some kind of contrasting thing, because I love the field of flowers, but I wanted something else to just kind of tie it together. And I thought that it might be a flock of birds, but after I painted this, I didn't like it very much. So that's okay. I think I probably would have liked more if I had painted a tree in the foreground, but that's where we are. And as you can see with the birds, they are basically different variations of a V shape. And I painted them in clusters and I varied the size and the shape, and kind of made it a zigzag all the way across the mountain. It's not that I think the birds look bad, they don't, but I think I would have rather had a tree if I did this all over again. But I am committed to showing you the first drafts of all these things that I do, to show you that your paintings don't always have to go as planned. Your ideas don't always have to go as planned. It can still be a really fun experience and a really cool painting. So that wraps it up. After I put the birds in that scene, I put my signature down on there, and that is my mountain meadows scene. even though I don't love the birds, I really do like this scene. Really love it, actually. I think that especially the splatters for the flowers combined with, you know, the texture of the leaves and the luminous pockets in the field just make it kind of look really magical and whimsical. It might not be super realistic, but again, I'm not really about realism here so much as I am about creating a magical experience as I'm painting it. So now let's talk about what I loved and what I learned. I'm pretty sure every single project that I do is, I love the luminous textures, I love the splatters. I love the tiny little details that I put together in this scene. The things that I learned is maybe skip the birds, maybe put a tree, and maybe, you know, try to mix the color of the sunset that I wanted ahead of time so that I can leave the bottom half of the paper wet so I don't have to use gouache. Maybe I would do something else to the mountain. But honestly, I think this scene turned out really cool. And I hope that you had a fun time watching it. As a reminder, you can leave a comment if you want to enter the giveaway to win a copy of my book. Any comment, I would love to hear from you, and I will see you next time.